Hi, it's Liam. This is all temporary. Number four, we are a species that has a very, very, very short attention span and a very limited ability to look forward at consequences. If you ask the anthropologists, they'll tell you that we came about as a foraging species. We were wanderers. We picked food where we could. So we had to think maybe a day, and maybe a half a day, maybe a day and a half ahead. Not much more than where the next couple meals coming from. Because we'd go out, we'd forage. We'd go to an area that looked like it was full of the grasshoppers and the roots and the berries, nuts, twigs, fish, little tiny things that we could catch without much trouble. And there were plenty. There were thousands, not millions. There were thousands of people on Earth. And maybe even if there were millions, we're talking about a big planet. So there's plenty of food. There's plenty of wildlife out there. There are plenty of fish to catch. There are plenty of frogs and grasshoppers to catch. It's not like you had to work very hard. You can ask the people who've done, you know, run the numbers in their own way to try to create an economic assessment of how much work you have to put in a day to be a happy forager. It's not that much. It's hours, but it's not 12 hours. It's not 10. It's not 8. Maybe it's 6. Maybe it's less. I mean, if you're in a large group and you're all collecting, you just need the calories to supply you for a day and a half. That's all you need, because you're going to do the same thing the next day, and then you have a surplus. The extra half is just for sharing. So anyway, that's life for a couple hundred thousand or maybe a couple million years of being a human or an early human. That's where we came up. We came up in this tribal species, this group thinking, let's gather enough food so that we can sing and dance around the campfire, gather a little bit of wood. That's us. We'll cuddle. We'll maybe have some sex. It'll be fun. Get up tomorrow, wash in the stream, do it again. That's us. That's really who we are. Deep down, that's what the human species is. Somewhere along the way, we started to organize into larger groups, and we wanted to, we picked plants that year after year after year after year after year that we liked. We dropped the seeds in one place. We played with the plants and inbred them and crossed this one with this one. And nature is sort of full of these wonderful tricks, almost as though there's a mind working behind it, although the Darwinists would refuse to acknowledge that. Almost as though there were sort of tricks and traps made so that if you inbreed the docile animals from a wild bunch, they'll shift the way that they look within a few generations, and they'll become mottled or piebald or... their legs will shorten and their bodies will thicken and their ears will flop and they'll become essentially a much tamer animal. Just for selecting for one quality, they'll have a variety of changes that occur in the physical and the psychological. So who can explain that? Anyway, it's sort of magic. But we did that, and we had inbred plants, which did the same thing. They get fatter and juicier and better tasting to our tastes and fewer seeds, etc. We did this just by mixing strands of plants that we liked and maybe cutting a hole in one plant and grafting and shoving in a branch from another and tying it up with some, you know, some hemp fiber. Well, it worked. So we started making these plants and animals do our bidding. We didn't have to go as far to forage, and we got more and more calories out of it, you know, and eventually it became the way that we lived. Well, these early foragers had to gather maybe, you know, when they would go out and gather, they'd gather maybe 5 to 10 times the amount of calories that they'd actually use during the gathering. Because you have to fund yourself essentially for the whole day, and then you have to maybe help feed a couple of the kids in the group. You know, that's what you do, you're a tribe. So that's not very hard. That's what people did. Well, farmers ended up, in the beginning it was tough because they didn't have as good luck. But when they figured out how to drip irrigate and do the other kinds of irrigation and do... crop rotation, they ended up making a lot of extra calories. And sure, there were some bad years, but they had a lot of extra energy to use to feed people, which meant that people could break into different groups and do different things, become artists or blacksmiths and use wood or this black stuff they found, coal, to heat these minerals that they could melt under in the fire and make shapes of them and make things with them. And so society really, you know, the city-state really starts at the point of agriculture and animal inbreeding. But we're still, for millions of years, we're this short-term creature that wanders about and gathers food and lays down for the night and has some sex and gets up in the morning, and that's life. I mean, that's it. That's what we are. Then along comes oil. I mean, we're talking 3 million years, and then in a 100-year period, 150 years, this super-powered black fluid comes along that lets us do anything we want with metal. The oil itself can become any kind of shape or density, you know, with a variety of densities. Some of it's heat resistant, some of it burns, called these plastics. And we can shape metal, and we can make engine blocks. We can do so much with it. But we're still this species that really never had to think more than about a day ahead. So we don't really know what we don't really think, like, well, what's the long-term effect of building an engine? I mean, this oil stuff probably is limited. I mean, eventually we're going to run, oh, who cares? Let's take this engine, put it in a horseless carriage, and put everybody's house on the furthest road from the field. Get as far away from the field and as you can, and we'll take one of these horseless carriages with these exploding things, and we'll put everybody at the end of one of these long, long roads. We'll actually make the road out of the oil, too, because, you know, I mean, eventually we're run out of it, but not today that we're making it. So everybody can live as far away from the food, but that'll be okay. I mean, what's the worst that could happen? Because we're not used to thinking more than a day ahead as a species. Then somebody finds this stuff and they start playing with it, and it causes all kinds of diseases, and they think, well, we can burn people with this. It gives off radio waves. It's radioactive. You know what we could do? We could try to explode it. What's the worst that could happen? You know what we should try to do? We should try to boil water with this stuff, because then we could spin a wheel and make electricity. No other way to make electricity than to take the most dangerous substance that we've ever found, refine it into the most dangerous substance that ever existed, boil water with it. Because we're only used to thinking about a day ahead. We can't think about what a 10,000-year half-life, what 10,000-year half-life, what 250,000 years of radioactivity is. We can't comprehend it because we're a simple foraging species that found oil. And that's probably going to kill this civilization, really. It'll probably destroy this civilization because we can't think ahead. We're not nearly as smart as we are good with our hands. We're good machinists, we're good tool makers, but we're really dumb. We have no great insight, we have no patience, and we don't see more than the next meal or the next excitement or the next turn on, the next chemical stimulation. That's what we are. This is Liam Scheff. You can buy my book, Official Stories, at Amazon.com. Please support independent journalism by doing so. See you next time. Wait a second. That's not the button. That's the button. I gotta go.